Final Fantasy X brings some innovative new features to the renowned Final Fantasy series. For the first time, we get to hear voices of all the major characters.
Why don't we let our summoner show us what she's made of?
And there's also the capability to swap characters in and out of your active party at any time. The battle system returns to a turn-based system, with the frequency of the turns being determined by each character's agility stat. The usual selection of mini-games also make an appearance, including mastering the sport of Blitzball and learning the Albed language. One of the most intriguing new additions is the unique character development system using the Sphere Board. Rather than having levels, you gain AP that can be spent to move an avatar through this strange track system. Each square on the board can modify your statistics, and you can explore different avenues of the board with different characters as you progress through the game. Final Fantasy X is already out in the US, and is due for release in the UK on the 1st of May.
Goodbye.
Endgame is the upcoming light gun title from Empire Interactive, and this is a sneak preview of the game in an early stage of development. The finished game will feature more in the way of special effects, as well as a whole alternate world to battle through, set deep within cyberspace. The plot concerns the battle of our heroine, Jade, as she tries to unravel the machinations of the sinister Eurodream Corporation. This fight takes her through numerous real-world locations, such as this bridge in Paris and a running battle down the length of a freight train. But the virtual world will feature much more bizarre opposition and considerably different weapons, requiring a completely new strategy. With its promises of variable opponent AI and a branching storyline, we're certainly looking forward to seeing a more complete version later this year. Turok Evolution returns the Nintendo series back to its roots. You're set to battle the reptilian hordes once again, fighting with a whole new array of exciting weapons against Lord Tyrannus and the Lost Land's 32 different types of prehistoric and indigenous creatures. There are huge, destroyable environments to play in, and even the chance to soar through the air on Dinobag. As you can see, Turok is far from extinct. Hot Wheels takes us back to those childhood days of super-fast racing and spectacular stunts. Join with Team Hot Wheels and help defend Monument City from a gang of racing villains. Take to the roads in more than 45 authentic Hot Wheel cars, performing wild aerial stunts, huge loops, banked turns and lightning-fast accelerations. Collect 15 offensive and defensive power-ups and complete missions by wiping out your challengers while blowing large holes in the scenery. On top of the compelling story, there are also three multiplayer modes to compete in: head-to-head, battle mode and stunt challenge. It's time to shift your imagination into overdrive. In the near future, Formula One has become too dull, bogged down with weighty regulations and legislation, causing a breakaway group of adrenaline-pumped drivers to form their own high-octane racing league. This is the world of Downforce. It features 14 modified F1 cars, four of which need to be unlocked. All of them can achieve some astounding speeds, although they also break apart in spectacular fashion when you botch a corner. We're promised no two crashes will be the same. There are six cities to race through: Tokyo, Las Vegas, Sydney, Singapore, Florida and Hong Kong, each with three routes to try out. You can then unlock a further two cities, Toronto and Geneva, which contain three more routes. Downforce features seven game modes, three difficulty levels, fast edited highlights, adaptive AI, and impressive sound effects. Gentlemen, start your engines. One of the things that really stood out during Star Wars Episode 1 was the pod racing sequence. It was destined to become a racing game, and here it is.
It takes split-second reflexes, a will of iron, supernatural control and concentration, and the near-suicidal drive and ambition to pilot what can only be called the fastest and deadliest racecraft in existence.
There's a welcome lack of fogging, and the races are all incredibly smooth and fast.
Oh, look at that abuse!
The tracks are well designed with plenty of surprises, alternate routes and exciting scenery, allowing you to show off some fancy flying. And there are five worlds to race on, each with significantly different terrain to cope with, although the jungle setting leaves a bit to be desired.
He's really throwing his weight around on the track!
The opposition are very aggressive.
Oh, and Albarbito goes down!
Trying their hardest to push you out of the race and into the scenery.
For all your collision and repair needs, check out Watto's Repair Bay.
This is entertaining to begin with, but can soon become annoying when you're crowded for every second of every race.
Look at that beatdown!
Fortunately, you score extra points for totaling the opposition, so it's worth pushing back for more than just some breathing room.
Flaming wreckage is everywhere!
You also get a choice of control methods. For the straightforward approach and the chance to concentrate on the track, there's the normal control method seen in so many other racing games. But more adventurous players can use the two analog sticks, each controlling one of the engines. This takes plenty of coordination, but can be really satisfying when you pull it off. Disappointingly, the whole season of 13 races can be completed in less than 4 hours.
That's gonna be one expensive repair bill.
And the difficulty level seems to peak in the middle of that period. The Boontar Eve Classic finale is surprisingly easy with all your shiny new upgrades. This short lifespan is stretched somewhat by all the features that you'll unlock along the way, and the desire to upgrade your new pods to the max.
He just will not be pushed around.
The multiplayer mode is also something of a disappointment, but overall, Racer Revenge proves to be a decent bit of high-speed action.
Mandrell taking a beating out there. Experience the pulse-pounding excitement, fierce competition, tragic defeats, and heroic victories. So tune in for the fastest sport in the galaxy. Pod Racing, back with a vengeance.
Star Wars Jedi Starfighter 2 brings Episode 2 to your PS2 even before the movie is released. Unfortunately, the three stars of the game bear no resemblance to anyone who has been or ever will be in the movies. Fortunately, the locations and vehicles are taken from the movies.
This ship is not for sale. It is a prototype that may become a powerful aid to the Jedi.
Sending in reinforcements.
Nim, this is the Liberator. We can't get any closer. Those station defense cannons will punch right through us.
The game bears a strong resemblance to the previous Starfighter game. This time round, it still comes with a selection of deep space and planet-side missions, but there's not much in the way of exciting new features. It certainly looks better, and you get a total of 40 new craft, including the massive capital ships, many of which appear in the movie. In addition, there are over 20 big missions and an enjoyable cooperative mode.
I'm under fire!
You gave her the comm codes too? Ready when I'm done with you, you're gonna be stuffed and mounted!
You and Orsai are carrying enough explosives to blow us all to Coruscant. We're gonna make sure at least one of you gets into the sensor station to take it out.
We're ready, Nim.
There are four force powers to play with, which can be used every 30 seconds or so when the energy bar recovers. These allow you to pull off tricks, like reflecting enemy shots back at them, adding a whole new tactical element to the space fighting.
We're coming up on Nim's last known coordinates. Muckworms! Doesn't look good.
Then give us cover while Jenkins slices into the Trade Federation planetary network.
Enemy sighted!
Entire combat system!
Now is not the time.
Your wingmates are controlled from a separate navigation menu, but as usual, they're hopelessly ineffective. They are very enthusiastic, though, and make a good show of filling the sky with laser fire.
Launch the backup surveillance device!
Friendly fire! Friendly fire!
It can become a bit dull fighting wave after wave of enemies, and the graphics lag a bit in the planet missions, but Jedi Starfighter 2 is still an essential buy for Star Wars fans.
Fragments.
Blood Omen 2 sees the return of the ancient and bloodthirsty vampire Cain, ensuring that this is not a game for the faint of heart.
You were struck down and destroyed.
Death.
Awakening 200 years after his last appearance, he's fighting to rebuild his powers.
I am Uma, and I am here to help you.
From the shards of tattered dreams, I rose. I am Cain.
You have been asleep for 200 years. This is what has become of Nazgûl. Blood is your life. Vampires possess dark gifts. You have the ability to assume a mist form. Know that you are stronger and faster than mortal men. Able to jump higher and farther than any human that ever lived. It's time for you to learn how to kill.
I needed little training in how to kill.
With simple controls, well-designed levels, and the chance to be subtle and cunning if you so desire, Blood Omen 2 looks set to bring the fun back into action adventures. You can find out more about the return of everyone's favorite vampire in this month's magazine preview. The Vampire Lord is back, and he's back in style.
Tell them Cain is coming.
Final Fantasy XI is set to be the first massively multiplayer online role-playing game to arrive on any console. Unlike previous games such as Phantasy Star Online, Squaresoft's bold venture into online-only games will allow thousands of players to share in a single fantastic world, a world more akin to PC classics like EverQuest. Players can meet up with each other, chat, exchange equipment and information, form parties and set out on epic quests together. Communication is handled through an easy system of world inputs, much like the icon-based communication in Phantasy Star Online. So when you're interested in joining a party, you just select the Join Party option and an icon appears next to your name to indicate your availability. Or, to lead a party, simply select Invite to Party and the player in question will be offered the chance to join your cause. Parties can consist of up to 6 players, but some tasks will require even more cooperation to complete. In these situations, up to 3 parties can come together to form an alliance. To avoid confusion, party leaders are marked with a yellow icon and alliance leaders have a white icon. When high-level characters form an alliance, they're ready to take on even the toughest challenges the world has to offer. The world of Varna Gyal is also home to some absolutely gorgeous landscapes, featuring all manner of terrain and constructions. You can explore through the rolling landscapes, visiting steam-filled deserts, rolling green hills, tranquil lakes, ancient ruins, labyrinthine tunnels, and much more besides. You can even interact with a lot of it, making use of the natural effects to reach new areas and putting all that technology to good use. All of these locations are filled with exciting creatures to discover, admire, and beat into submission. And there are even some people that you might just want to talk to in order to uncover more of the exciting storyline. Everything is nicely rendered and looks beautiful, with impressive lighting effects providing the finishing touch. Varna Gyal is a world of swords, magic and technology, and you can be sure that all of these elements are going to look spectacular in the usual Squaresoft fashion. The magic system includes a wide variety of spells, all of which come with some nifty special effects that really enliven the combat situations. The spells available to you depend on your character choices. The cute and lovable Tarutaru are renowned for their magic-wielding capabilities, but the other species have their own take on the magical arts as well. Offensive, defensive, or utility, allowing you to blow away monsters in dramatic fashion, then repair yourself and your team afterwards with a barrage of healing spells. As with the communication system, the spells are activated through a simple menu system, so they're always ready at hand when you need them. Is second only to Formula One in terms of attendance and popularity in Europe. And now, for the first time on PS2, Super Trucks brings all that heavy-duty, high-speed action straight into your hands. There are 7 real-life international circuits, including Zolder in Belgium, Spain's Jarama circuit, and the new Euro Speedway course in Germany. Themselves are supplied by world-renowned manufacturers such as CAT, MAN and Mercedes, authentically recreated here from the schematics of 14 officially licensed teams. And they can all be tuned to compensate for the various weather conditions and damage that they'll have to face. selection of game modes, including single and arcade races, time trials, pan-European competitions available as single or split-screen two-player games, and five championships. Complete these and you'll unlock even more toys to play with. The gameplay has been balanced to show the aggression, power and incredible speeds of these massive vehicles, while still letting you feel the immediacy of a gripping racing game. The AI responds to your driving style in order to make the most of your weaknesses. The graphics are very sharp and realistic damage features mean that the tracks soon become littered with debris as the trucks pound hell out of each other on the grueling circuits. So if you appreciate the chance to burn some rubber, but Formula One is too fragile for your sensibilities, then Super Trucks is definitely a racing game to look out for. Football game today is going to invite comparison to Pro Evolution Soccer, and they're going to have to do a lot to beat it. But ISS 2 is taking a sensible approach by offering something a little different.
Only has to beat the keeper. He'll try one.
Yellow card. ISS
2 sets out to provide an easily accessible but highly enjoyable and action-packed game, creating a much more arcadey feel than Pro Evolution Soccer's strict realism and skill requirements. The controls are similar, but the system is much more forgiving, and so the action comes thick and fast with plenty of goal math activity.
Here's an opening. We'll now have a penalty shootout to decide this game. Pesky with the responsibility of the first penalty. Barnwell is getting ready. Incredible, the keeper stopped it! Headed up by Dyson.
The tactics are also handled in a much more simple fashion, meaning there's less work to do in setting up your team before the match. The commentary is probably better still, with the voices of John Champion and Mark Lawrenson providing an excitable and involved dialogue that gels well with the action on the pitch.
Now, what about that? Has he got a yellow card? No, he'll just get a warning from the referee. And a header! Oh, agonizingly close! Chested down, that one is interesting.
There are 58 international teams to choose from, with the real likenesses of the players and their proper names, and all the usual cups and tournaments. But disappointingly, you get no league teams or Master League type challenge.
The key to stopping them is to disrupt their flow by shutting them down early. Thanks, Mark. It looks like the referee is about to get the game underway. Now it's with Owen.
The graphics look good and you can easily get into the heat of the action. It makes putting the ball in the back of the net a really satisfying experience.
Chance for a cross here. Can he get a decent cross in? He's got it well. Yes, it's there!
Despite the stiff competition, ISS 2 looks set to make a name for itself as the casual player's footy game.
The applause goes round the whole crowd inside the stadium.
Entertainment is rapidly becoming a big market, with big names like Parappa the Rapper and Space Channel 5 being joined by newcomers like Rez and Now Frequency. Frequency comes with what is probably the best selection of music ever to hit PS2. including 25 tracks from quality artists in a wide range of styles. And you get the chance to remix and generally muck about with the whole lot. Each stage features a single tune and a flight down this mesmerizing tunnel. A different element of the current track, such as the drum section, vocals or bass line, is represented by one of the eight tunnel walls. And as you hurtle down the tunnel, you're faced with cymbals left, right and centre, which you need to match in sequence on the joypad in order to initialise that element of the music. The meter on the right keeps track of your progress through the stage, and the aim is to complete each of the elements before the end of the section. On top of that, if you make mistakes, your power bar becomes depleted, and if you pick up the bonuses, then you can multiply your score or automatically play the track to the end of that section. But it's not all about collecting points. Most of the entertainment comes from mixing in different parts of the music, experiencing the effects that you can generate, and watching the psychedelic kaleidoscope that fills the screen. The only drawback is the same old problem that plagues a lot of rhythm games. It's a lot more interesting for those watching than the person who has to keep their eyes on the cymbals all the time. Fortunately, since the major feature is the music, this doesn't pose too much of a disadvantage. Gran Turismo may be the real driving simulator, but it falls short when it comes to the actual racing. Then again, Test Drive doesn't really have a glowing track record from its PS1 days. Can they turn this around and take the latest Test Drive where Gran Turismo failed to go? Quite possibly. The main draw comes in the form of the new story mode. You play Dennis Black, an ex-racing driver who's turned to the illegal road racing scene to make ends meet. There are four cities to visit, somewhat predictably San Francisco, London, Monaco and Tokyo, all of which have had all the large sections of their street plans carefully modelled. There's about a dozen courses per city. You're free to explore the streets at your leisure, so long as you make it through the checkpoints and to the end of the course before the timer runs out. The only real obstacles in your way are the other road users and, of course, the police, who tend to frown on such things as roaring through the streets of San Francisco using half-laden skips to jump over intersections. To add to the fun, you'll also encounter boss characters. Beat these guys and you can acquire more desirable cars. Speaking of which, there are over 20 to get your hands on, including the usual array of Imprezas, Skylines and Celicas. But you can also get to play with some big American muscle cars for guaranteed amusement. Test Drive certainly looks impressive, and despite the familiar locations, the car selection and storyline could well mean that it'll give GT3 a run for its money. Most stable of people, but when it comes to big names in boxing, there's none more memorable. And so it's unsurprising that Codemasters has chosen to use him as the mascot for its new boxing game. Mike Tyson Heavyweight Boxing features 14 licensed boxers, each of which has his own signature punch, in addition to the 36 generic attacks, including illegal moves and over 500 combos.
Come on, get it, Chewy!
There's a whole range of blocks, ducks, sways, taunts and big hits, which can be combined to create a wide range of tactics and fighting styles. But they're not easy to pull off. All of the more impressive moves require careful preparation and timing. Button mashing isn't going to be a winner in this one. If it all goes wrong and you end up chewing the canvas, you get to play the get-up game. Match the symbols beneath the meter and get your struggling pugilist back on his feet. This puts them back in the fight, but it won't do anything to cure the fully modelled facial damage. The other modes consist of Tyson's Challenge, Undisputed Champ and Speed Boxing. Then you have a chance to create your own boxer as well, choosing your own appearance, entrance music and taunts. Professional commentary, real-life arenas and plenty to unlock, and things are looking good. As a roaming 3D beat-em-up, Eve of Extinction is the latest fight fest from the people who brought us WWF SmackDown. You play Josh, who has just discovered that his employers are developing a weapon of mass destruction, the Legacy, by fusing the human soul with a crystal. Taking the sensible course of action when faced with a plot like that, he tries to make a run for it with his girlfriend, but that doesn't work, and he's soon captured and introduced firsthand to the experiments.
Show him what you've got.
Fortunately, being a hero and all, he manages to escape, and now he's setting out to save his girl, the world, and anything else that takes his fancy along the way. What this bizarre and implausible story actually means is that you have to demolish absolutely everything that wanders into your path. Except your girlfriend, of course. Probably shouldn't attack her.
There must be a way.
This is an early version of the game, so there's still time for improvements to be made and more detail to be added. Fingers crossed. Ubisoft's Pro Rally returns for its 2002 installment with a whole host of new features. Ubisoft claims that the rallying experience has been adapted for console gaming, meaning that the cars behave in a more arcade-like fashion. The racing is simple, fast and fun, with wide and fast tracks to compete on. There are 20 licensed cars to play with, including the now mandatory Imprezas and Lancer Evo 7s. Each vehicle has its own behaviour and can be tuned to perfection as well. You get to thrash these poor defenceless motors on a total of 48 tracks, made up of more than 175 kilometres of roads. Surfaces vary from bog standard tarmac to soil, mud and snow, all in a variety of weather conditions. There are seven racing modes consisting of the five we're already familiar with and two new modes called Trophy and Arcade, where you can compete against your friends on parallel tracks. Fancy a straightforward rallying game with no mechanical complications, then keep your eyes on the road for the arrival of Pro Rally 2002.
Status.
Captain, we have reports of secondary EPS conduits on decks 8 and 9 rupturing.
Photon torpedoes, full spread.
Trekkies rejoice. Star Trek Voyager Elite Force is the fabulous first-person shooter that actually does justice to the Star Trek setting. Already immensely popular on PC, it's now coming to PlayStation 2. There's a totally new story, created by one of the show's writers. Here we find Voyager trapped without power in an uncharted space junkyard. As a member of the away team, Ensign Monroe and his teammates must search the surrounding wrecks for a means of escape. But not all of these space hulks are deserted, and a whole menagerie of alien scavengers want a piece of you.
Monroe to Tuvok. I've been cut off from the rest of the hazard team. I don't know where they are.
There are lots of familiar species to be found here, along with a few new ones, and all of them are going to require a unique approach. Some you can fight, others will require a more stealthy approach.
Sir, I was hit. The Borg took the team through there.
Out, Chang.
Whatever happens, it's up to you to make the most of your team and ensure that they all return safely.
Thanks, Monroe. I'll get Odell back to the ship.
Even when the mission takes an unexpected turn for the worse.
EPS conduits are gonna block! Hit that panel and bring up a containment field!
You'll get to interact with all the significant members of the Voyager crew. Some will join you on missions and others debrief you, but not everyone has time for the petty concerns of a lowly hazard team member.
Ensign Monroe, you're wearing a hazard suit. Get down to engineering and help B'Elanna seal that leak.
Here, Monroe, take this.
You even get to hear the real voices of Tuvok and the Doctor.
If you need medical attention, just come back here.
Elite Force carries all the atmosphere of the Star Trek universe, whilst plunging you into the middle of the action. And it even manages to be an excellent first-person shooter in its own right. Certainly worth monitoring closely. Aliens have invaded and they're forcing people to dance. The premise for Space Channel 5 Part 1 is simple, if a touch bizarre. The year is 2499 and you play sexy reporter Ulala, who is covering the event for Space Channel 5 while fighting off the aliens at the same time.
It's Space Channel 5 again. Take this.
To do this, she has to be better at dancing than they are. This is accomplished by watching their moves and repeating them with perfect timing when it's your turn. Despite its simple nature, the bright and colourful action is incredibly addictive and, to put it simply, great fun.
More flames up ahead!
The whole game only lasts about an hour, even once you've unlocked the extras, and it's almost impossible to actually lose, but that doesn't seem to detract from the appeal at all. If you manage to hit the cue spot on, then you get more people dancing with you and the whole atmosphere picks up. But bodge a few prompts and you'll soon find yourself dancing alone, with a dejected and dispirited Ooh-la-la trying desperately to keep the alien menace at bay. The graphics are gorgeous and the sound is unsurprisingly great, and the whole package jumps along at a great pace, keeping you interested all the way. So simple and so short, it'll still be a game that you'll come back to time and time again. Fantastic fun.
Here goes nothing.
All right!
Stay tuned.
Prepare to have your mind reduced to noodles as Parappa the Rapper 2 hits PS2. Noodles.
At first, I liked it, but now, I can't believe.
Wow, that's a cool afro.
Parappa's hometown is suffering from the horrendous noodleization effect, causing all the food and even hair to turn into noodles. The only way to put a stop to this is to master some funky rapping techniques.
But that afro looks good on you.
Don't say that!
The 8 short chapters unfold with tales of miniaturization, joining the army, romantic karate, battling noodle hair, and all manner of other weirdness.
Anything goes, Ethan, Hawaii. Anything goes, even Alaska.
Audio quality is great, with each of the characters having their own personal sound and style, which is fortunate considering the whole game is based around your ability to follow the music. And the graphics are also gorgeous, with all the characters having a huge range of facial expressions that really help you get into the silliness of the story. The problem is that you spend the entire game watching the symbols at the top of the screen. If you take a moment to watch the action, then you're bound to miss one of the cues and mess up your timing. From then on, it's all downhill and it'll be noodles for everyone at dinner time. There are some games, the cream of the crop, that instantly become classics. Games like Tetris and Buster Move. But the problem with these archetypes is the slew of instantly forgettable clones that they spawn in their wake. Worms Blast is unashamedly similar to Buster Move and Puzzle Bobble, but dosed with a healthy dollop of Worms formula. and as clones go, this one makes a concerted effort to float above the mediocrity. The playing style is familiar to anyone who's played those games, but with the inclusion of the traditional Worms arsenal, fired with the usual combination of elevation and power. The complications, your hero has to manage all of this while perched in a precariously bobbing raft on a constantly rising water level. And if that doesn't sound enough like a Japanese endurance game show for you, then there's the multiplayer challenge, where your opponent makes every effort to sink you while staying afloat himself. The single-player game is huge, with over 60 puzzles of increasing difficulty scattered throughout the world map. Tournament mode contains even more challenges, with the simple aim of staying alive. But it's the two-player mode that's likely to hold your interest longest, even though it's not quite as competitive as games like Buster Move. It's all tremendous fun, and could well be one of the best puzzlers on the PS2. But the multiplayer mode just isn't as ferocious or devious as it should be. Kessen 2 delivers all the great heroes from the ancient Chinese novel Romance of the Three Kingdoms. And just like the original game, concentrates on the strategic side of warfare, but with a new emphasis on heroic characters and powerful magic.
You Bei! He's actually
going! Right from the start, the cutscenes do seem to drag on a bit, but they're certainly impressive to watch. Here, your closest allies present war counseling to help strengthen your military might through 30 historical stomping grounds.
No, we will save her.
Battle strategies are also presented for your consideration, all of which have a direct influence over your next skirmish. Here, your armies are controllable from the easily accessed map screen, providing a useful overview of the terrain and increasingly tricky attack formations of the enemy. A rather limited form of interaction overall, but the well-judged learning curve provides serious slaughter in the later scenarios.
Brand your hide with Ma Chao!
Close-up control can be rather awkward at times, and cutting a sway through the chaos will often inflict casualties on both sides. This tedious task of thinning out the enemy numbers makes for a slow-paced experience overall, and the only thing that will keep you returning to the scene of the battle is sheer desperation to watch the next beautifully crafted cut scene. If you're after something deep, it's certainly worth a look, but otherwise you'll be hard-pushed to find any immediate thrills here.
About time, huh?
You're now looking at one of the worst games ever made for PS2. Johnny Mosley Mad Tricks is everything that SSX Tricky is not.
Parallel with the 360.
For a start, it's laughably slow. As your skier makes his way down the virtually horizontal slopes, you almost expect him to grind to a halt at any moment.
180. Speed freak.
And it's not as if there's anything to see as you trundle along the featureless courses.
Double back.
It's the video game equivalent of a drive up the M1 in a Reliant Robin.
Freaked out combo.
To call the tricks mad is stretching the truth to breaking point.
Combo with the whip combo.
Spinning, skiing backwards, and going up small ramps is about as insane as it gets.
Fill grab with a rodeo. rail slide.
It scores 1 out of 10. We've said enough. You've seen enough. Next!
Rail slide with a fill grab.
Fancy a change of pace from all the guns and racing? Ico is just the tonic you've been looking for. Set among the ancient stones of a strange old castle, you're presented with a constant challenge in the form of intricate puzzles as you try to rescue the princess and keep the shadowy forces of the Dark Queen at bay. This is Ico, a young boy who's been exiled from his village because of the horns growing out of his head. The superstitious villagers locked him away in the deserted stronghold, where he begins to have visions of a princess held within the walls. He soon finds her prison, and his adventure really begins. The game consists almost entirely of exploring the marvellously detailed and gorgeously ethereal castle, as you find or create an easy route in order to lead the fragile princess, Yorda, to freedom. The puzzles flow together well, and don't come across as simply a series of hurdles, but as a beautifully flowing storyline. The only interruptions in the serene wanderings of our diminutive hero are the occasional assaults by the shadow monsters, sent by the sinister Dark Queen to capture Yorda. These fights seem eerily appropriate in the general ambience of the game, with the only sounds being Ico's desperate attempts to fight the things off. Yorda does a good job of being completely vague, getting distracted by the animals and needing to be continually led around. The first time through the game, you get no clues about what she's saying to you, but things will become a little clearer the second time around. With a calm, haunting atmosphere, a thought-provoking series of puzzles, and an evocative storyline, the whole game is relaxing and refreshing, while still providing an ample challenge. Adventures in Neverland is clearly aimed at children, and while the very young may find it amusing for a short time, the chances are that most will get bored very quickly.
Let me fly, Peter, please.
Okay, Danny, we need a little of Tink's pixie dust first. Tink? Well, where are you, Tink? Where's she gone to now?
Peter!
That said, the graphics are pretty good. The scenery is crisp and solid, and the characters look fine, although possibly a little too smug for comfort. The story is simple enough. Due to unfortunate circumstances, Peter Pan has lost his powers of flight, and in order to regain it, has to charge around the island gathering pixie dust jars, treasure, and maps. Determined to prevent his hyperactive behaviour are a small army of pirates, crabs, snakes, bees, crocodiles, and other subtropical troublemakers. And there's no need to be concerned about Peter's reckless use of sharp instruments. All his opponents are clearly just dazed by his ferocious assaults. No pirates or fluffy animals were harmed in the production of this game. problem is that it's simple, straightforward, and basically just dull. The levels are as linear as you can get, the challenges fail to challenge, and even the occasional flying level is simply an aerial slalom. While it manages to be a more solid game than many licensed titles, Peter Pan was designed to amuse the under fives, and that's quite possibly all it'll do.
The pirates kidnapped you and the rest of the Lost Boys to keep me busy. It seems Captain Hook is searching for a hidden treasure map.
A treasure map? Wow!
When Shadow Man came to PS1, the poor little machine just couldn't cope. But now, with the power of PS2, Shadow Man's second coming is making up for its previous failings.
Johnny? What the?
Hey! Welcome home, honey.
Let's dance.
He's over there.
This time it's looking very polished, with every attack provoking a sparkling display of special effects and everything looking very realistic. So it's a shame that these visual displays are accompanied by a distinct feeling of vacancy.
I should get moving.
As you wander the streets of New Orleans, there's nothing much going on, which works fine out in the bayou, but comes across as strange in the city. Following on from the original plot, you play Mike Leroy.
Dead side, no place like home.
A man possessed of the ability to travel back and forth between the real world and the dead side. This happens every sunset, as Leroy transforms into Shadow Man, gaining variety advantages and flaws in the process.
I should get moving.
The dead side is much more exciting to behold, filled with freakish horrors that are just as hideous as they are formidable.
Johnny must be around here somewhere.
But sadly, the combat comes across as a bit clumsy, which can be unfortunate when facing off against the cunning AI.
Come right there.
Bloody idiot! I think I've broken my skull. My brains are sure to be pouring out all over the place any minute.
What brains?
On the plus side, the puzzles are spot on and the voice acting is very professional. Bursts onto the ninja scene, coming up against such opposition as Onimusha and Seven Blades. You get to play Hero the Ninja, faced with a wide selection of puzzles that, while they may not be the most challenging obstacles in the world, won't detract from the action at all. The main aspect of the game is the fighting, of which there's plenty.
Crap!
There are loads of flashy moves to pull off, and many of them actually prove to be useful as well. And the action just keeps on coming. The restricted view doesn't prove to be as irritating as you might first expect. Although it would be nice to see a bit more in the game's few open areas. The graphics can be a bit glitchy on occasion, but are generally good, including some decent water and motion blur effects, along with several amusing character animations. Character progression keeps things interesting as the game continues to grow, and being resurrected where you fell also keeps the action moving along nicely. Elemental Force works well as a game, albeit one with a slight smell of a budget title. King series has been around for a while, but it hasn't really progressed a great deal in all that time, yet it still manages to return to the shelves every year as a decent, true-to-life boxing simulation. But can it really survive against the more arcadey and more exciting Ready to Rumble series?
Better get those hands up!
That's a good right.
Head on that.
Frazier lands a hard hook upstairs.
Once more, there are no sweeping changes. However, there are several improvements worth noting. The motion capture has come on considerably, making the fighters look much better and move more realistically. They appear solid and realistic, with appropriate reactions to the action around them. The motion blending seamlessly merges different moves together, making the whole fight run very smoothly.
Good combination. Connected with the hard hook. Clean shot to the head. Locks the headshot. Landing a solid combination to the head. Solid right up there.
The speed of the action has also been turned up a notch, making the whole thing more dynamic. And there are some nice effects, such as the ropes around the ring and the stunned haze as you stare up blankly from the canvas. Even the AI has been tweaked so that you can tell the difference between the individual fighting styles.
You could have blocked that. Someone needs to teach this guy how to block.
The lineup includes numerous personalities, both contemporary and legendary. Everyone you'd expect is here, with the notable exceptions of Mike Tyson and Prince Nassim. They obviously have commitments elsewhere. The game modes extend to exhibition, tournament and career, the last of which allows you to take a fighter up from nothing and take him to the top. But the chances are that you'll spend most of your time in two-player mode, knocking the bejesus out of your mates. That's what it's all about, after all. All said and done, this is a perfectly acceptable boxing game, probably the best on the PS2, with the notable exception of Ready to Rumble, which simply puts it out for the count.
I am Zola Dane, royal seer and advisor to Lady Mishala. It is an honor to meet you.
Thank you.
Drakon, the ancient gates, has followed the wise marketing strategy of having an attractive female lead, but it has much more to offer than merely this, with an extensive storyline and some beautiful scenery. The action follows our heroine, Rin, and her talking dragon, marauding around the landscape, fighting monsters, talking to villagers, and looting everything in sight, before heading into town to purchase the latest in adventure sheep. The main plot is huge, with side quests being issued by almost everyone you meet. If anything, there's probably more to do here than is actually necessary.
And of them all, none was greater than the dragon mother, Malashe. It's said that if she can be awakened, so too will the last dragons of the Order.
But those are just legends.
The legends are true.
The controls are well designed and easy to master, and the combat system includes an interesting locking function, which means you can stay focused on a particular opponent while trying to avoid being hit. There are some great battles to be had flying on the back of your dragon, in which you get to breathe huge swathes of flame across your enemies.
Did you find the site, Arok?
I did, but the trees were too dense. I couldn't get close. I'm afraid I'll need you to journey into the swamps for me, Rin.
That's a fine greeting.
The graphics are beautiful, including some gorgeous rolling landscapes, highly detailed textures and objects, and some fantastic character models. As you visit locations, they automatically appear on your map, making navigation a cinch. and you can save the game any way you like, although it will eat up a large chunk of your memory card in the process.
Will you do as I ask?
Payment wizard, what can you offer us?
Two souls, priest.
While it may look like many other games that have gone before it, Drakken proves to be bigger, better, and much more fun than the majority of its competitors. Dynasty Warriors 3 is one of the most chaotic fighting experiences on PS2. And if you're bored of Tekken and Dead or Alive, this could be the answer.
Lend me your strength.
This latest barrage of bone-crunching violence now comes with three times the number of levels offered in Dynasty Warriors 2. Split between 23 stages with 40 characters to play with overall. But most impressive of all is the all-new two-player mode, which, awkward camera angles aside, provides a welcome new approach. Thankfully, the new visual additions haven't reduced the numbers of the heaving masses, and slaughtering the swarming enemy is more engaging than ever. And to make things even more spectacular, you must now string together more elaborate combos and take to horseback in the midst of the carnage. Unfortunately, there's a price to pay for so much visual excess, and the viewing distance in both single and multiplayer is limited through the rather dull fogging effect. Buildings, trees, and enemies appear from nowhere, but with so much mayhem to engage, you rarely have the time to take in the surroundings. Also, you're now given the opportunity to select your bodyguard formations. These faithful companions are always on hand to cover your back, and like your chosen character, gain valuable experience after a successful punch-up. Dynasty Warriors 3 soon becomes repetitive, but despite its considerable lack of depth, it's also tremendously gratifying to slay an entire legion of rampaging goons with easy-to-use combos. If you've never experienced the bedlam of Dynasty Warriors, then it's worth shelling out 40 quid to witness carnage on such a scale.
Messire, you will now learn what it costs to defy the Emperor. Murderer, you shall burn in hell.
Fuego.
Don Diego is fighting for the common man against the tyrannical Spanish governors. Using his alter ego, Zorro, he slices and dices his way through the Spanish soldiers with flair and grace, gaining a reputation as one of the greatest swordsmen who ever lived. So it's extremely surprising that a game about a legendary swordsman should not even give you the chance to swing a blade. Instead, you have to follow a series of on-screen symbols in order to trigger a particular combat sequence. It all looks very stylish, but leaves you with the feeling that you're not really contributing to the action. It's all very unsatisfying. The graphics are occasionally attractive, although the architecture can be a bit harsh, and it's all too often mired in darkness anyway. Zorro's cloak proves to be the high point of the visual effects, bringing a nice sense of drama to everything he does. But with the added drawbacks of long loading times, simplistic puzzles, and bad guys who respawn when you retrace your steps, the whole thing just becomes a frustrating disappointment. There's no shortage of snow-themed games around at the moment, and here's another one. Rather than going head-to-head with the awesome SSX Tricky, Dark Summit offers a winter sports game with a plot. It seems that harmful pollutants are being dumped on a popular ski resort, sections of which have been sealed off by security chief O'Leary. Your character, Naya, has been sent in to investigate, and she soon unearths a complex X-Files-style conspiracy involving aliens and military cover-ups. It's all very strange, but it does provide an incentive to keep on with the challenges.
Well, I haven't seen you here before.
Hey, sorry about that.
If I find out that some punk snowboarder isn't following the rules, then I will crack down.
You tell him, Chief.
Out on the slopes, you'll find the courses are absolutely huge and littered with all sorts of obstacles and interesting playthings to trick off. There are also lots of varied challenges to keep you occupied.
This is my day.
Even if some of them are a bit strange and disturbing. The tricks are easy to perform and usually look good, and there are a few special tricks that are a bit more taxing. You can learn more of these as you progress through the game, completing the challenges. The visuals are very nice, including some lovely animations and scenery interaction, and the game physics are spot on. You even get a multiplayer mode. The biggest problem is the sheer size of the courses.
Now this is getting interesting.
This is only the beginning.
Whilst it's great for just fooling about on, it's a real pitch to find all the challenge points and to discover where you're going in order to complete them. Dark Summit does a good job of putting a plot into a snowboarding game. Its visuals are beautiful, and the actual snowboarding is great fun. But it still doesn't quite manage to be as attractive as SSX Tricky, although it certainly makes a nice change. Herbert's Dune is one of the great classics of the sci-fi genre. So why is it that no one can produce a decent film or game about it?
Location. We are on Arrakis, otherwise known as Dune, the planet of sand. This is the only known source in the entire universe of the essential spice.
The effort is based on the recent TV miniseries rather than the book or the 1984 David Lynch movie. But it still fails to include the image of any of the actors. You play Paul Atreides, battling to defeat the evil schemes of the Baron Harkonnen, while making alliances with the desert Fremen, dodging the giant sandworms and struggling to avenge the destruction of your family.
Rabban, you must recapture Dune. Its surrender has been very costly to us. Our investment must pay dividends.
The Fremen are more than just a scattered bunch of natives. Our soldiers report that they are fearsome fighters.
Show yourself!
The idea is to use a mixture of stealth, cunning, and all-out violence to outmaneuver your opponents. But the whole thing falls far short of that ideal. For a start, the biggest problem isn't the Harkonnens or the worms, but the camera. You can choose to control it yourself using the right analog stick, or let the AI look after it for you. But neither method works at all well, often leaving you fighting creatures off the screen or desperately trying to evade the worms as you run into the camera shot. Graphics don't help. The worms look impressive, but the jerky animations and atrocious lip syncs are a sight that everyone on Dune is eating the wrong kind of spice.
Transport a
until we get to the ambush point. Has Baron explained how the SOS jammer works?
It jams the Harvester's communication network and sends a false SOS to the carryall.
The whole thing falls short of what it could have been. Dune is a great license, but even hardcore fans will find this offering leaves a bad taste in their mouths. There are plenty of better action games available on the PS2. Entries for the PSW Pro Evolution Soccer Goal of the Month competition are flooding in. Whittling the best down to three wasn't easy, but we finally settled on these spectacular efforts. In third place is the thunderous diving header from Simon Crampton that leaves the goalie standing after theatrical flying display from Veron. Michael English gets the runner-up spot with this mazy dribble by Mark Overmars through the Finland defence before finishing with clinical precision. But this issue's goal of the month was sent in by Luke Patterson from Cleveland. The speculative Beckham effort is reminiscent of that famous goal he scored from the halfway line. The free kick goes in from a huge distance, but you've got to ask questions about the positioning of the keeper. Virtua Fighter 4. Armed with a barrage of excessively powerful trick moves, pushes, shoves, throws and multi-link combos. What he lacks in all-out speed, he more than makes up for in guile and power. Getting the most out of his tough character will tax even the most seasoned Virtua Fighter player.
Ready, go!
Timing his combos is tough enough, but combine that with the complexity of the joypad commands and you'll soon see why not many people try to master this character. However, watch a VF master at work and you'll swoon in disbelief at the majesty of Akira's violence.
Fight one! Ready, go!
Jackie Bryant is the brother of the psychotic Sarah, and his entire Virtua Fighter career has been a mission to save her from her brainwashing masters. He uses a variation of Bruce Lee's fighting art, Jeet Kune Do, in order to pummel his opponents.
Fight two! Ready, go!
Just like Sarah, he specializes in inhumanely fast combination strikes, but whilst his sister leads with her legs, Jackie is immensely versatile and the ability to blend so many of his attacks into one fighting onslaught makes him a fearsome opponent.
Handcuff lightning!
Sate, tatakaimashou ka?
Fight one! Ready, go!
Brainwashed and turned into a devastating, sadistic killing machine, Sarah Bryant is a lightning-fast, totally ruthless fighter, armed with a swift attack for just about every kind of situation.
Fight two! Ready, go!
It's true to say that she can find a weakness to exploit in just about every other character. And in her VF4 incarnation, she's deadlier than ever. All new stances have been added to her repertoire of strikes, enabling her to reverse enemy attacks for the first time.
Yeah!
Let's begin.
Fight one. Ready, go!
Lei Fei is one of the two new Virtua Fighters who make the scene in this new game. A Shaolin monk, this guy combines power combos with a grace and agility that is truly wonderful to behold.
Fight two. Ready,
he has the ability to wrong-foot all of the established Virtua Fighter characters and can inflict massive amounts of damage with his enormous range of unpredictable combination attacks. Watching a Lei Fei master at work is to see poetry in motion. That is, if your idea of poetry includes a blood-curdling amount of brutality.
What are you doing?
Get away! Mm. さて、戦いましょうか?
Fight one! Ready, go!
This large Caribbean gentleman uses the ancient Roman fighting art of Pancratium in order to wreak horrendous amounts of violence against his foes. Possibly the slowest fighter in the entire game, but he's kitted out with attacks that can break down opponents' blocking moves, making even the most powerful opponent very vulnerable. Combine this with some of the most horrendous bone-crushing throws in the game, and you have a formidable opponent.
It seems to be... I'm the winner!
Feel the real power.
Aikido no Shinzui.
Fight one! Ready, go!
Virtua Fighter's token wrestler has always been something of a handful, but developers AM2 have upped the ante significantly with the all-new incarnation.
Fight two! Ready, go!
Although he is one of the slowest fighters in the game, Wolf is packed with trick moves that give him a definite advantage. For a start, he's the master of attacking at range and boasts unblockable charges that no fighter can defend against. In close, his powerful throws and wrestling holds inflict some of the highest levels of violence seen in the game.
Let's fight again!